What's up, everybody? Nice to see you back. Wish you a happy new year 2018 once again. So today's topic is an extension of a topic which we discussed recently: why predictions fail and when we should not go to an astrologer. Oh my god, so many heavy things in that video. So if you have not watched that video, then please go and watch it. Otherwise, you may not understand what I am speaking in this video. Okay, it's there in this playlist itself, somewhere one, two videos above. Alright, if you are new to the channel and you have not yet subscribed, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a personal consultation, then approach me in my website below, Vedic Renaissance, and book accordingly. And if you like this video, click the thumbs up at the end. And if you have any other questions, queries or comments, or if you want me to make any other video, then let me know in the comment section. Alright, there you go. Before I begin, as I always say, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and He will be there for you in the new year and throughout the year also, and for every year to come. All right, so today's topic is extension for that topic: why predictions fail. We explained in that video that when we are undergoing a bad time, or we have those combinations in our chart, or when transits are not favorable, that is the time we may get not totally benefited by astrology and astrologers. Yes, that can happen. That is something to do with our karma, as I already said, and also to be a bit proactive, that when certain planets are transiting in difficult houses, we do not go and waste our time with astrologers. Yes, what did I say there? Jupiter, Sun and the ninth lord. When these three are transiting in difficult houses, all three, then it's not recommended we waste our money by going to astrologers. Okay, although if it's a very bad emergency, we can go, there's no problem, but then things can happen which may not turn out to be very fruitful. Yes, so if your Jupiter is transiting in a difficult house, that will be for 1 year, so at least wait till Sun or the ninth lord goes to a good house. All right, and then you approach a consultation. Or you make sure that even if you approach when Sun is in a difficult house, the consultation date which you finalize, or which that astrologer gives to you, is when Sun is in a good house, okay, or the ninth lord, at least one of the three. But today what we are going to discuss is, today is another astrological video of why predictions go wrong, and this has to do with foolishness. When I say foolishness, it simply means that whenever I upload videos, I have seen this with myself and with every other astrologer in YouTube and in different forums also. Now recently I had made a video, symptoms of debilitated Venus. Then another video I made on some other topic. Then some people said, oh, we don't agree to what you are saying. It is not happening with me. No, this planet is like this, that planet is like that, but what you are saying is not happening. Well, please understand, just because you have a good Jupiter or a bad Venus, it doesn't mean the whole story regarding that planet. Yes, so this is one of the biggest reasons why predictions fail. You do not see the whole chart. Should I repeat? You do not see the whole chart. That is why your predictions fail. All right, which simply means you get obsessed and bogged with one particular planet and its placement. It doesn't work like that. I wish life would be so simple. See, the problem is life is very complex. Yes, and that is why astrology is also very complex, because astrology is what, basically, on a higher level, it is nothing but our life, basically. Yes, higher, lower, mid level, any level you say, it's basically our life, what's going on in our life, that is explained by astrology. So if we are seeing that certain areas in our life have challenges, irrespective of the placement of that planet, we have to understand that we have to work on it. For example, if relationships are always a challenge for us, then we have to realize that even if our Venus is exalted in Pisces, or it's in Libra, or it's in Taurus, we have to do things by which we have to improve that, by taking it to the sign of Pisces. That means by being more spiritual, by being more happy inside with ourselves, rather than searching out happiness in a partner. Because very soon our expectations may be baffled. We may be encountering frustration always, because No partner in this universe, however beautiful, however rich, however loving they may be, they can fulfill our needs. It is not possible. Only God can do that. Okay. That means we have to study the whole horoscope. And when we don't do that, when we just see one planet and we get obsessed, oh, this is good, this is bad, it doesn't work that way. That is why you will see people writing in the comments, oh, you said, like, I had made a video on love marriage or something, I said about Venus and Rahu, and then that person said, oh, you said Venus Rahu people will cheat or they'll get cheated, but I have never cheated anybody. I'm like, can't you understand this simple meaning, that that is an indication. If Jupiter is well placed in your chart, that will not happen, alright? But you will still have an indication to fall in love with somebody who is from a different culture, creed, religion or background or different society, alright? That will happen. But suppose Jupiter is in the Lagna, then that is reducing that effect, because Jupiter represents culture, traditions, morals, okay? Then you will be like, okay, no, maybe I should follow the norm of the society. If Moon is also there, then this will improve, this will increase, alright? Which means if Moon is with Jupiter and if you have a Venus-Rahu conjunction, depending on the strength of Jupiter, Moon and Venus-Rahu, depending on the sign and the house, we will say which will work more powerfully. The nature of Venus-Rahu, which says break traditions, or the nature of Jupiter-Moon, which says no, no, don't break traditions, stay with the tradition, alright? So like that, you have to study the chart and then you have to study where the Lord of the Ascendant is. Which sign is in the ascendant, which sign is in the seventh house, which sign is Venus, the natural karaka for relationships is placed, which planets are aspecting Venus. That is why I get very angry whenever somebody says, oh, you have now Mars Rahu in the seventh house, you will have a divorce. I mean, come on, seriously. There are so many people born with these placements, because for 2 hours, there will be so many people who will be born with Mars in the seventh. Or Rahu in the 7th, yes, or Ketu in the 7th. Well, then that means everybody born in that 2 hours, they will have a divorce. No, it's not like that. It is simply one of the indications that your marriage can have certain difficulties. But divorce is a separate issue. Divorce is basically what? A decision that we cannot stay together. Yes, we have to part our ways. So, just because you have a benefic, it doesn't mean that you will never have divorce. Okay. Now somebody will think, oh, that means if I have a benefic, I will have divorce. No, for God's sake, don't think like that, okay? What I'm saying is, there's a big difference between having quarrels in marriage and having divorces, okay? Both are completely different things. Of course, divorce is the extreme form of intolerance which you have towards each other. Otherwise, you will not divorce, right? But just because you have a malefic in the 7th house, don't get bogged up and think, oh my God, my marriage is over. Oh my God, my Venus is debilitated. What I will do? No, it doesn't work like that. You have to see the whole chart. Because, always remember this, every planet, wherever it is sitting, it will throw some aspect on every other house. It will contribute some points in Ashtagvarga scheme, about which I will discuss later. Okay. So suppose Saturn is aspecting your 7th house, then you will say that, okay, maybe there are delays in marriage. But what if Jupiter is aspecting? Or what if other benefics like Moon, Venus or Mercury is aspecting? Then you will see, oh, marriage has come early. For India, early marriage may be 23, 24. For Germany, early marriage may be 27, 28. Alright? And for India, late marriage may be in 28, 29, 30. And for Germany, late marriage may be after 35. So now we will say, okay, now what is happening? Saturn's aspect is not working maybe in this chart. No, it's not like that. Because the benefics are aspecting, that is why the marriage has happened early. Now, the interesting thing is, if Saturn would not aspect, and if all the benefics would be aspecting, then you would have got married much more earlier than that. Yes, now you understand how the game is happening. So, we have to understand in totality how the overall chart is functioning, okay? So, importance of seeing the overall chart is very much emphasized by everybody. That is why I feel very funny when I see videos like, oh, Jupiter in the 7th house. Now, I'm not saying that you should not make those videos. I will also make, but I feel it very funny when somebody judges their entire marriage by the placement of Jupiter in the seventh house. Yes. So for example, suppose you are a Capricorn ascendant, then Jupiter is ruling difficult houses. Yes. 3, 12. Now suppose that is sitting in the seventh house in Cancer. That is a exaltation. So now what will you say? 12th Lord exalted in the seventh house. Is it good or bad? But then you may say good for what? Bad for what? So you see, so you have to know how to interpret the whole chart. That is why I do not like to do live consultations, because that's like cheating. Yes, I'm laughing. It's actually cheating. You have to see 1,000 different things when you are doing a consultation. That is why whenever somebody approaches me for consultation, then I spend minutes and hours seeing the chart from top to bottom. So many things have to be seen. Yes, that is why whenever somebody says, oh, why don't you do live readings during during live sessions, I'm like, I'm a normal human being. I'm not Parashara. I'm not a Rishi that, okay, you just see a chart and you're like, bang, 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 this will happen. It doesn't work like that. At least with me, it doesn't work. Maybe there are some superhumans who work like that. Okay, just for the sake of getting money, maybe they do it. Now, I'm not saying that don't say anything about the chart by seeing the placements. All right, so suppose I'm doing a live reading and somebody is asking me that my Jupiter is in the second house. Yes, what will happen? Then I may give an interpretation. But if somebody asks me, tell me about my marriage, that I cannot say by Jupiter or Venus in the seventh. For that, I have to see which dashas you are running for the rest of your life. Yes, that is why recently somebody had asked me a question that I have these planets placed. How will be my marital life? I said, I can't answer that question. I have to see your dashas. Yes, dasha is basically what? Dasha, I have not talked about it. I will talk about it very soon. Dasha means for a particular time period, one particular planet among the nine becomes active fully. And that time, that planet is your focus, traits related to that house, where it is sitting and the natural significations of that house and also the houses which is it is ruling. So suppose you have three dashas coming, okay? Saturn, then you have your Mercury, and suppose you are in your Rahu Mahadasha, then you will have Jupiter, Saturn and Mercury. So I have to see the situation of all these three planets in the chart, all right? Only then I can say. So whenever we are expecting answers in a live reading, we must be very careful, because I don't know where your sun is, I don't know which lagna you are, I don't know which house your lagna lord is placed, and then for me to just give a prediction in air, okay, maybe this will happen, that will happen, it doesn't work out. And then somebody will blast me, oh, you said this will happen but that didn't happen. There you see. So the problem is not with me, or the problem is not with you, the problem is that we have to see the whole chart. Yes, without that, whenever we try to give predictions, it's such a waste of time, money and intelligence. Yes, it's like you go to a doctor and the doctor will not see the disease. The doctor will see your eyes. The doctor will see, are you eating properly? Are you sleeping? So many things the doctor will see, right? So the doctor cannot just say that, okay, your leg is injured, go and put this in your leg. It doesn't work like that. Because that injury may have some other complications. Yes, it may not be a general injury at all. So you have to see the whole chart. And when you don't do that, you will get into wrong predictions. All right. And then you will go and blaspheme astrologers, or you will go and blaspheme the science of astrology that it doesn't work. No, it works. Unless the person is not well qualified to see. Unless that happens, or unless you are doing a wrong analysis yourself. All right. So this is the main reason why predictions fail. All right. So we do not see the whole chart. We just see one thing and then we have declared, okay, Ketu in the seventh house, my marriage will split. Why? Ketu is Caesar, right? There you go. Your marriage is ending, right? Or no, we don't know. We have to see the whole chart. So whenever you see videos in the internet where you see Mars in the seventh house, now it's Mangalik Dosha, the person will die, the partner will die. So first of all, you have to see what's the longevity of that person who you are marrying. Yes, if that person is having less longevity, either you are a Manglik or you are not. that person will die and you will stay as a widow. Yes. Now, if that person has a long life and you are supposedly a Manglik, so don't worry, that person will not die. So there you see. Now, this video is not on Manglik, but I am touching slightly because that topic is very much overhyped, overrated in India. Yes. And on the other side, Western astrology has completely downplayed its role. Western astrology, so many astrologers I know in YouTube, they say, oh, there's nothing called as Manglik Doshana. That is just a way by which Indian astrologers gain money. What they're saying is true, but the inference is not correct. That has weightage, but both are wrong. To say that, oh, you have Mars in the 7th, so your spouse will die, that is one level of stupidity. And the other extreme is to say, no, no, nothing happens, it's just Mars, no, it's not a big deal. So both are wrong. Both are stupid, actually. Yes. And there you will find so many stupid people roaming everywhere headlessly, and they have so many followers also. Recently I was seeing one channel in YouTube, with all due respect, they are giving predictions for 12 zodiac signs, what will happen in the year 2018. And I'm like, seriously? Seriously? And these people have so many followers also. Such blatant lies. Okay, for Sagittarius, Jupiter is in the 11th house. So all your gains, hopes, wishes, desires will be fulfilled. What nonsense is this, man? The person who is speaking this is also a fool. And the people who are hearing, they are like, forget it. In Bhagavatam it is said, blind leading the blind to the ditch. You just want to hear something good. Okay, Jupiter is in the 11th house, everything will be good. It doesn't work like that. I wish it worked. That doesn't mean that you do not see transit videos. But you have to see your overall chart. You have to check the dasha. So many things you have to see. Yes. The yogas, the combinations, is the event promised in your birth chart? That's the first thing you have to see. If that is not promised, it will not happen. Yes, irrespective of whichever dasha you are running, whichever transit it is. For example, if you are not supposed to get married, take the example of, let's take the example of our Indian Prime Minister. Yes, Narendra Modi. Now, I am ignoring the controversy which he has regarding one woman, that he is married or he is not, in his childhood or in his young age, forget that. But at the end of the day, he doesn't have a wife now with him, yes? So he is basically living like a celibate, essentially. Even if he was married with one lady, or he left her or she left him, or whatever it is, forget about it. So now you will say, oh, next year Jupiter will transit to Scorpio. So from there it will aspect some house in his birth chart maybe. So for Narendra Modi, there's a debate. Some say he's a Scorpio ascendant, some say he's a Libra ascendant. Alright. So now if you take him to be a Libra ascendant, then next year when Jupiter transits to Scorpio, it will transit the second house, right? For Libra, Scorpio is the second house. Second, 7th and 11th are houses of marriage. 2, 7, 11. But then why will he not get married still next year? Yes, why? Because he has that yoga in his chart that he will never get married. Yes, or he will not be in that feminine association. He has that yoga. So when you have that yoga, in last 65 years, Jupiter and Saturn has transited 100 times into his second house, 7th house, 11th house. They have aspected countless times. If you are not destined to get married, that will not happen, which will be there by the yoga, by the combination. Yes. So first you check the yoga, and now somebody will write to me that, okay, please tell me that yoga which he has. No, I will not give all those yogas. All those are negative yogas which will create morbid fears unnecessarily. All right. And this video is not to make all those combinations visible to people. It's not about that. It's simply to make you realize that unless you see the whole chart, you check the dashas, and then you use transits, it will lead to disaster. You will give wrong predictions. All right. And especially if you are going on seeing things like, okay, in Hindi na, there is this so many channels in TV, there is aaj hum dekhte hai na 2018 मीन राशि के जातकों के लिए कैसा रहेगा. आई एम लाइक, ओ माई गॉड, सीरियसली? दे आर गिविंग प्रेडिक्शंस अबाउट वन ज़ोडियाक साइन, विच मीन्स देर आर 7 billion people, एंड इफ यू डिवाइड इट इनटू 12, रफली इट विल कम टू हाउ मेनी? 50 करोड़. 50 crore people, they are telling, okay, you will have a good time. But for them, many of them, their father may die, their mother may die, they may get divorced. And then they will go and say, oh, this rascal astrologer told me, na, I saw in that TV that I will have a good time, but now it is not happening. So astrology is useless. Astrology is bogus. It's a blatant bunch of lies which they have spread out, right? No, it's not like that. You are getting fooled by going to people who are fooling you. Yes? So protect yourself. Don't go to such people who just see one thing and they will give you the whole prediction. Yes? Don't fool yourself. Protect yourself, okay? Because I don't want that you get cheated, nor do I want that after you get cheated, you blaspheme and you generalize astrologers or you generalize the science of astrology. Yes? Both are wrong. Alright? So please see the whole chart and only then make predictions. Alright? Otherwise, refrain. Okay, that is it from my side. Wish you all the best in delineating charts of people and in understanding your own chart also. And if you're new to the channel and you have not yet subscribed, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me, then approach me in my website below. And if you like this video, click the thumbs up. And if you have any questions, queries or comments, then let me know. And if you want me to make any other video, then also let me know in the comment section. Okay. Until next time, wish you good luck with seeing the whole chart. Bye-bye. See you.